you've spent a lot of time to create, I guess, I hope, amazing products. We'll see. And so we won't lose more time to start just right now. And so for voting criteria, my bad, we're going to call the first team, which is Alpha Shen. So Alpha Shen, guys, got 5 minutes.
So hi everyone. Sorry for the little delay, and I'm too early. It's okay. Hi again, everyone. Welcome to our Merkle Week Hackathon project presentation called Volta Chain. So our project is a payment channel solution for power delivery. So to remind you the context, nowadays there's one charging station for 80 electric vehicles in France. There are a lot of expensive costs caused by the payment fees and the infrastructure that slow down the deployment of the charging station. There's also the flat rate pricing caused by the forfeit in the charging station. So the global problem is how to give easier access to charging station and reducing the cost of the infrastructure. Our objectives are to allow anybody to offer a charging service for all the people, reducing the cost for the infrastructure and the payment fees, and allow the people to pay for only what they consume. So I let you, Pierre, now present you the prerequisites.
So for our solution, we need a working lightning network, we need a liberal energy market, and internet connection for charging station. We are based on lightning networks, so you can see here the consumer's application is node, the node of the producer, the application of the producer, then the charging station. Here's our second diagram. You got the client app which asks to the provider for energy, then the provider app asks to the node to create a payment request. This payment request goes to the client node. The client node does the payment. Payment is received, then the meter is unlocked.
Now we're gonna do a little demonstration. So Pierre will comment some charge.
You don't see it,
but I will ask for a charge of 10 seconds, and you will see the phone will charge in quickly. So it starts to charge. When the 10 seconds are done, the power is shut down, and here.
So, did you like it? I think everyone here. I think everyone hear about this kind of project, but this solution is not only for power or energy market. You can adapt it for any kind of goods which is quantified.
Well,
Thanks for your attention.
Thank you.
Can you detail more how do you reduce? In the beginning, you.
Hello, in the beginning of the pitch, you explained that you reduce the costs. Can you really detail how is it achieved and what kind of cost reduction can we expect?
So, for the infrastructure which is now in the town, they are all controlled by one company or many other companies which control their own infrastructure. So when you own infrastructure and you have to control all of them, you have to put people to maintain this infrastructure in terms of information, informatics, security, etc. So it costs a little, and the infrastructure costs also to create them and to deploy them into all the country. So our solution is to allow that people, that practical people, can put their own infrastructure in their own in their home, and they are just them control their own infrastructure. So this is why there is a reducing of cost of the general cost of the solution.
By using Lightning Network, we can do transaction with a very low fees. And that's one part of our reducing cost.
Cool. And on the technical aspect of it, so what did you implement there? The demo was not really clear on what's happening. So I would like to know if it's working, how it's working, and stuff like that.
It's working. The user make a payment to the supplier, so the supplier unlocks the meter. That's all.
Okay, and you're using Lightning, so is it working now?
Yep.
Yeah.
On the testnet, yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
We use an implementation from François Mazuré for the Lightning client. We can show you again for one other transaction, if you want it.
Yeah, no, it's fine for me. So I have another question, which is about the payments. So I don't really know how it works right now with electric vehicles. Sorry about that. But so for your stuff to work, I have to lock some money first on Lightning, right? So how do you expect people to do that? So you're already assuming that everybody is using Lightning Network, or what?
Yes, I assume they use it because I think the bank will tell them one day or another this tech is better for the bank, so you have to use it.
Okay, so people need Bitcoin first, and then they need to use Lightning, and then they need an electric vehicle, and then, yeah.
We live in future.
Cool.
Good.
Good.
Okay, so next team. And so next team is the Closers Bringers Network.
Network. You hear me?
Yeah.
Okay. It's a lead generation rewarding between freelancers. Sorry for my poor accents. The problem to solve as an apporteur d'affaires is three of them. Adding value, not cost, to the client project. The second one, it's not having to think anymore when I have to be paid for the commercial work I have done. And the third, it's to increase the trust and professional relationship quality. A quick look of the architecture. It's a peer-to-peer network, no backend. The communication between devices will be with these three kind of canal, QR code, WebRTC data channel chat, or SMS. The Bitcoin protocol is used as a way to answer the question, why a blockchain? To store value, the marketing budget of the freelancer is reserved upfront for remuneration of the member of the network. And to use the multi-sig feature to retrieve and release the value stored. We will begin we will start with the Copay open source sources. Here the demo.
Okay.
In the story, Alice bring a deal with the client to Bob. I have an app, and in this app, Bob has a network of freelancers. And he can add some people with a QR code. So here Bob is scanning Alice's QR code to add her in his network. So then Alice is added in the Bob network. Bob has an account. And he can add or extract some fund to his marketing budget. And you see other information to follow what is on the way out or what is on the way in. Next. Bob can share his account with others, showing his QR code. Okay. Alice has brought a deal to Bob, so Bob sends to Alice a part of the future revenue of the deal. Bob gives some information about the deal, the revenue of the deal, the date when the deal will be done, the client name, client email, clientele, telephone, and then Bob choose the quality certifier, which name Nestor. After that, Bob fixes the rewards for the future work here. Nestor will have 600 milli BTC and Alice 1000. And then transactions are sent, and it's a multisig address with 3K network, Nestor, Alice, and Bob. Nestor has a special board because he has some work to be done. He need to telephone sometimes the client and has some question, like is the quality of Bob precision okay? What do you think Bob could do to improve his performance? And his Bob has been paid. It's finished? Sorry, I'm being quicker. Then, if the deal is done, like Bob he's paid, then the Nestor can send to Alice the fund. And if the deal...
On va devoir couper.
Yes, sorry.
Okay. So, good. I have one question first, and then I'll give it to the other judges. What's the problem you're trying to solve exactly? The real problem that exists today that you're solving with your app?
The real problem is when we... the real problem is that when we bring a deal, we have to think about when I will be paid for that commercial work. And the other problem is just like that, it's just a cost for the client, and I don't want it to be a cost. I want to be I want to add value to the client project. So I need a Nestor in the story to add a new regard, look on the deal, and to get feedback and to professionalize the team.
Okay, and what make second question. What makes the person sure that they are getting paid? So I'm not sure. Like you're talking about agreeing on the cost. So you are locking this money first.
Yeah.
So who had the power to send this money? It wasn't very clear for me. Because you were talking about multisig, but the multisig. I mean, if one of the people having the right to sign didn't work at all, they can still sign. So how do you solve the problem of...
It's a 2-3 multisig. So Nestor or Alice can sign, Nestor or Bob, or even if Nestor doesn't do his work, then it's Alice and Bob.
Okay, so if you have two people not doing anything, they can still take the money?
Yes.
Okay.
There is a this collusion kind of...
How do you solve the problems that when the client pays in euro and you make your multisig in Bitcoin, so with the volatility, what's the...
Oh, it's not a problem. I think Bitcoin have a great future. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, so next team. Thank you, Karina, for the presentation. You can leave the microphone here. So next team is Yolo Bid.
Hi everyone. So we are the YellowBid team. So YellowBid is a new like decentralized platform, which is non-profit for like allowing users like to blockchain introduced a billing platform. So for the classic billing experience, you go on the a website, a centralized website, which takes fees for high fees, because it's a profit-oriented company. You can think of eBay or company like this. And so for every transaction you get fees, and you have to pay fees. So this is not a good deal for the buyer. And you're not because it's a profit-oriented company. You have no clue about the next policy change. Will be more profit oriented, so this is not good as well for the seller. Okay, yeah. So how answer to this is it's Yellowbit, a decentralized bidding platform based on Ethereum. We have two main incentives. So no more cheating, So adding trust, it's a big deal. When you put an item online, you're not really sure that you will get the money when you're a seller, because the first buyer you don't have an imprint on his money. He just said, you suppose he has it on his account, but you're not sure. And so we are doing this imprint. So when you bid, the amount is locked for 1 hour at least. And we are non-profit, so we get rid of fees. And just we ask a little participation for maintenance. So this is, So why blockchain? So I said it already, so because it's decentralized. So no more middle party. So we mainly get rid of the centralized party, and with the participation, it's a reliable platform. So Alberic will explain to you how it works.
Okay, so let's speak about the practical part, practical explanation. We are working with Ethereum. The seller is creating a contract, a smart contract, with his specification, the time, the minimum amount of money to get the product. And there is some buyers, one, two, or three, bidding on this product. The buyer one just he bid, but now he just want to be refunded. It's not possible now. The money is blocked on the contract during at least 1 hour. So it's a security part. So buyer cannot cheat on the contract.
Can you stop, please? Can you show us a demo right now, please?
Okay.
You've got 1 minute.
So we did a little video for the demo. So the seller will create a contract. So we will show you on Parity, but we'll do the website. He is creating a contract for his item. You can put an ID, a name, you can put a minimum amount, a duration. So the duration is in second now. And now the buyer will be able to bid on the product. So the first one is putting 5 Ether. And we can see that the 5 Ether are on the contract. The second one is putting 12, I think. And he is now the best buyer, the best bidder.
Silver, guys, silver. I go to the question right now.
Okay. So good.
Allez-y, hein.
Vous avez vos questions ?
According to you, what's the innovation you're bringing to end users?
I think we couldn't show you right now, but like we want to build based on the Web3 API, the JavaScript API. We want to build a website, it looks like a normal website, but it's a gate to the blockchain environment. Bidding portal, blockchain bidding portal, on a typical website. So it's getting the non-technical user to the blockchain environment in a very simple way.
How do you make sure I'm getting my frozen baby delivered to my home, and when is the money released?
So at the end of the process, the seller is saying that the time is finished. All the bidders that are not the best one are getting those money refunds. And the willing buyer has to say that he received the shipment, the item, and then the money is unlocked by the smart contract and sending to the seller.
And one thing is when you bid, the money is transferred, is blocked. So the winner, when he wins, he doesn't have any He cannot refuse to pay because it doesn't matter.
One bonus question. If you win 7,000 euros in Bitcoin, what we would do? Short answer, please.
I think the only thing we need to be ready for is a security audit of our smart contract, and then we will develop the based on the Web3 API,
Okay, you just need time, you don't need money. Okay, thanks you guys.
Time is money.
Okay, so next team is Virtuous Trader. Here. Today the problem we are trying to assess is customer to customer markets. These markets have a lot of risk of frauds at this point of time. The insurance processes are really clumsy and tiring. So we'll be trying to assess this problem in the market by our solution called Virtuous Trade, where every fraud fails. The solution we are trying to propose is we'll be talking about the French e-commerce market right now. If we see the hits on Google, it's say around 41 million per month. But at the same time, Le Bon Coin, one of the largest C2C market of France, has around 19 million of it. So this proves that C2C market is not going anywhere yet. It has a lot of problems to be solved.
The solution which we propose here is a reputation-based recognition system, which is emphasized by immutable smart contracts, transaction power of blockchain, and dispute resolution with the help of the community and not one single authority, which is happening today. We will show you a smart demo right now. So, let's take, for example, Leboncoin.fr. What is happening here is we'll be going on the first listing, say Collection Jew Final Fantasy. We'll try to buy it. It's one click buying process. So as soon as you hit, a smart contract is triggered. And using your Ethereum wallet in this case, the product is bought. If you have certain kind of a dispute, you can raise the issue right there. Here you can see in the transaction history where the transaction is processed and the thing is bought. The transaction ID is returned. We can go in the dispute and claim for a dispute. Say you need to give the reason why you're trying to return and give a proof of the dispute. In this case, it can be the ticket or maybe let's say a broken iPhone in some case, or you need to just upload an image. The hash of the image is taken, which proves that the thing is not tampered. The transaction ID is returned and the dispute is stored. At the same time, whatever description was mentioned during the advertisement of the project product is also saved to serve as a proof in the future dispute process. The community can also close the dispute once they have decided if A's person is the winner or the B person is the winner. We'll go further and see what are the targets we are trying to achieve here. Okay, my friend is trying to show you that that reason which we have given in the dispute is can be traced from the smart contract, just giving by identification number. Yeah, this is the amount of the price, which was say 150 with some weird characters there. The thing is not received, the complaint which we gave. Definitely the solution is not 100% ready, but is possible to make it. The targets which we are trying to achieve is pretty clear. The C2C transaction costs will be reduced. The frauds will definitely go down significantly. We will create a virtuous circle of trade, which will benefit the whole community and give a trust layer for trading further. We don't plan to open a marketplace, but it would be more like a plugin to existing big market players like Leboncoin or any Amazon or any other such market players. The transactions are taken care of by the blockchain. You can open a dispute. The dispute is resolved by the community, wherein if the buyer is a fraud, then the seller gets the money. If the seller is a frauder, then buyer gets the money. In case if the dispute is not resolved by the community, the funds are locked in the contract. And these funds serve as the incentive for the whole community, as in because they play the role of jury in this case. The reputation system helps us to exactly identify the seller, which sellers are better, which sellers are not. So, all in all, resolving all the trust issues. Also, one thing to be noted is we are rewarding the bad behavior, rewarding the good behavior, and punishing for the bad behavior. This is what emphasizes the security of the situation. We are free to answer your questions. Thank you.
What's the cost of your system? Me as a buyer or as a seller, how much fees do I have?
In fact, the cost is very low for customers because there is no insurance properly said. In fact, the insurance is a network. Okay, so the fees will be distributed to the different people like a jury. It's not in order to reward a jury and be incentive for to play the game. Did I answer to the question?
Yeah, it's fine. Okay. I have another one.
Does it work on other platforms such as Amazon and those kind of stuff?
Yes, the goal is to make partnership with different platforms. We don't want to create a platform. We want to platform as already users. So we want to profit to this platform in order to make a business with them.
And why Ethereum? Why not Bitcoin?
Because it's really easy for the POC. It's not
so good.
Because we know this.
but
we have to investigate on which blockchain we have to use. I'm sure it's not, I think it's not the good one, but...
What's the difference between your project and the other project from Karin? Just a little bit.
In fact, there is already a market like Amazon, like Le Bon Coin. It's already existing. We want just to improve.
I'm not talking about the front end. I'm talking about the choice of the platform.
I don't remember the project of Bitcoin exactly.
Bitcoin.
Okay. So what is the point? I'm not sure to understand.
I think we can create some more complex contract on Ethereum, and we plan to integrate a reputation system.
Why complex contract?
Multi signature is also in Bitcoin, but reputation and what else?
It's scale better. Is it right?
I don't say it's better, but...
No, I mean, it's scale better.
I scale better? Yeah.
No, Ethereum scale better.
Yeah.
I mean, the smart contract can scale better.
The point is not the technology, Ethereum or Bitcoin. As we said, we are agnostic. We just made a POC on Ethereum. And maybe the next one, I don't know, it could be... Ripple or it's not the topic of this talk. It's just business plan, business model, not technology.
So the point is to use a decentralized system basically, and to be able to provide transparent transactions to the users so that they have the trust that okay, there's a decentralized system behind it, and unlike centralized systems which is actually prone to hacks, and the governing authority can do a lot of whatever they want in that sense, right? So the governance here is the key, I think, since it is also community-based dispute resolution. So when we resolve the disputes in community and use of smart contracts, so I think all this adds to the value of the platform. So it's more about using a decentralized system.
Is it really decentralized? Hey, can you prove it?
No, we discuss, we don't have a really decentralized system, but yes, sometimes we need a third party in order to make business. It's a little the case for this one, but we have to be tolerant with this idea.
Okay, thank you. And so the next project is Patreon.
One question more, please.
Ah, yeah. Last question.
Okay, so this one is a bit different. What's the incentive for the seller? Because right now, as I see your system, the seller can only lose. If he actually send the product, and for whatever reason there is a dispute, do we lose the money?
No, not at all. In fact, if you send the package, he can prove it by tracking number, or make a picture of the ticket and prove that I sent something.
Okay, so it still didn't win anything. So why would he use it then?
No. He can prove that he sent something, so he will have the money.
Yeah, but he will have the money otherwise as well. Because like, let's say if today I buy something on Le Bon Coin, right?
Yes.
I get the money first, then I send the package. So why do I need to use your stuff?
Because I'm not paying insurance against eBay, and we will have more customers because it's a secure platform. for the customer, for the buyer, it's a secure platform.
Okay.
How do I connect to? Hello everyone. Let me introduce you to our project, which is called Patreon, and which implements a new type of crowdfunding using decentralized smart contracts on the Ethereum platform. Most of you probably are familiar with some of these payment providers, which among other things offer recurrent payments. One of the prominent examples is Patreon, which lets users support their favorite creators, that is musicians or programmers or artists, with monthly pledges. But we see multiple problems with existing solutions and we try to solve them. So the first problem is that users are forced to reveal private information, starting from your name and address and also your banking details, which some of the users may be reluctant to give away. The second problem is that the fees are high. For the creator to withdraw money that he has collected on the platform requires paying a fee from 5% or even more, and including the credit card fees. And the third problem is that the creator has to trust the platform, the creator has to trust that he will receive the money at the end of the day. So we solve these problems with the smart contract. Privacy of users is preserved because the only thing that's required is Ethereum address and some coins, and the user can support favorite artist, favorite creator. The fees are low. There are no fees except for usual Ethereum transaction costs, and that costs on the order of a couple of US cents, which is much less than existing solutions. And we use the trustless execution by the Ethereum network. That means that only the creator and the supporter can withdraw money according to the rules predefined in the source code. So everybody can look at it, everybody can see that nobody can run away with the money. So imagine Alice. She deposits some coins into the smart contract, and every month Bob the musician and Charlie the programmer receive a pledge. But then after some time Charlie decides to become lazy and does nothing, and Alice cancels her pledge to Charlie, but continues to support Bob. So, and now it's time for demonstration of our possible user interface. So imagine Alice, she has a balance of $100. She already supports Bob here, and she also wants now to support Charlie. And she adds Charlie to the list of creators she supports. So now Charlie knows that he will receive $5 next month. So some time passes. Charlie received $15 and then he became lazy and Alice decided to cancel her pledge. So she canceled her pledge. Charlie doesn't expect any money to be received next month, but he can withdraw $15 that he earned in the previous month. So we implemented our solution with a smart contract in Solidity and uploaded it on GitHub. You can have a look. So that's basically it. Thank you.
Thank you.
I think it's really cool, especially on the aspect of that you said can't be blocked or like anonymous kind of. How do you do anonymity on, so I have like two or three questions at the same time. How do you do anonymity on Ethereum? We all know that Ethereum is not a real blockchain because it's not censorship resistant, as the DAO showed. So how do you make sure the funds are still available? So yeah, privacy, and how do you make sure the funds can't be locked?
Okay, we don't implement any additional privacy preserving features. We just based on the assumption that user is not required to provide any additional information except for the Ethereum address.
and what you said about the censorship resistant and all the stuff. So we implemented our contract in Solidity, and it can be as well deployed on the Ethereum Classic blockchain as well as on the Ethereum blockchain. So you can choose.
Yay.
So yeah, you had like a wireframe, but what do you have on the GitHub there? What's working, what's not?
We have a complete smart contract in Solidity that does the basic features, like as a supporter, you can deposit some Ether, you can create a pledge, so you can say, I'm gonna, for the next, say, 6 months, every month, I pledge to this address that amount of money. And then, anytime, a supporter can withdraw the remaining amount, and the creator can withdraw the amount that had been paid so far. So the funds are locked in the smart contract, and so only the supporter and the creator can withdraw partially these funds, depending on the time and the conditions in code.
And that's already working?
Yes, we at least we tested it in the in-browser Solidity compiler. Yes, it's working. You can test it also.
Okay.
Thank you.
Just a bonus question. What will you do if you win the first cash prize? What's next for the project? How money will help you?
There are some kind of additional features we may want to implement. We'll think about that.
Can you tell us which are those features?
For example, one of the features is like probably so. For now, in our current implementation, all pledges are denominated in Ether, or more precisely, in Wei. But maybe for the users, it will be more convenient to see dollars and euros in the in their accounts. And to do that, we may want to connect some kind of external oracle that would connect to an exchange and report the current exchange rate of Ether to dollars or to euros, so that it would be more convenient for users. So kind of one of possible next step could be like this.
Do you have any plan to spread your product? Did you contact a YouTuber or those kind of guys?
Not yet, but
are you in touch?
As the first step for making our project more public, we uploaded the code to GitHub. So it's like step number one. Then, yeah.
There's a lot of projects you release the code on GitHub and nothing happened after. So how the money could help you kickstart?
At least we can write that we are the winners of the hackathon. That also adds to our publicity. So maybe you'll post some
questions about us. That's not my question, and that's not enough. Are you in touch with people who produce content?
Not yet, but we will.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
And so the next is Diaphanous.
To make this possible.
You win.
So, we're here to present you Diaphanous. It's an auditable vote system. Just to start, let's the name needs an explanation maybe. So why did we choose diaphanous? Because diaphanous means transparent, which lets the light go through. And the nous is the reason in ancient Greek philosophy. The ability to find truth, the intuition to find truth. So it's the base to make good decisions, to vote. What did we use? The Bitcoin blockchain and colored coin. We created a smartphone app for end users, the voters, and an admin interface for the vote organizer. So first, we need to really narrow the scope of what is not diaphanous and what is diaphanous. It's not a liquid democracy tool, and it's not a direct democracy tool. Or you might have an Orwellian tool, so don't use it for direct democracy. Use it for trusted decision making. And this is agnostic of the trust source. It can be democratic or authoritarian. So trusted representatives in direct democracies like UN National Security Councils or authoritarian sources like hackathon judges, for instance. As a matter of fact, you need to have these votes openly visible to anyone, and in direct democracy, strictly confidential to anyone. And so in indirect democracy, you trade, as a matter of fact, trust against accountability. That's why you need to have this auditable. And now we'll show you how this translates into technical features.
Okay, well, this is the breakdown of our solution. The left part is about the server who is matching all the public key with the outcomes and broadcasting the transaction to the blockchain. On the left part, we have an iOS application with the wallet for the private seed for each user and Blockchain Explorer. So these are the four main features. So it's end-to-end verifiable. Like from the beginning for the participant to the outcomes of the votes. So it's visible to anyone because it's on the blockchain, so everyone sees the same things. And then the consensus fraud proof is enabled from the blockchain. It prevents double spending, someone saying yes and then in the future saying no. It's facilitated because even if it's on the blockchain, it's easy to use, the application is really user friendly. So as you can see, it's a single page. So you can choose between all the votes. So for example, European Union, you choose yes or no. Then you can see on the other page, it's the metadata of the transaction. For example, there is the output. This one are the token left to the participant. And there, this always corresponds to the value yes to the vote. So here is for the user view. I'll show you the back part, back end of the solution with the blockchain Bitcoin. So this part is about the client. So you can see the outcome of the votes. For example, this one we did it before because we needed confirmation. So you can see this, meaning six participants voted for this outcome. So this outcome corresponds to this one, so the yes. And for the user one, if I want to vote, this for the user, I can vote. Choose this one, for example. This is yes. So there's a text ID, so it means it's good. And if we see the outcomes, one address has disappeared, so it's not yet on this address because it's not yet confirmed on the blockchain, but it has disappeared from here. And if we just check out on the Explorer, we can see that it has happened correctly. The token has been sent. From there, it has been sent from this address to this address. And later, when it's confirmed, you can see on the...
It's over. Thank you, guys. So, question? So, the first question is, obviously this is centralized, so why are you spamming the Bitcoin blockchain?
So I don't think we're spamming the blockchain Bitcoin. We are using features from it, like the transparency that everyone can see everything, and you are not relying on someone who is saying, so the outcome is this thing, or this outcome is this thing. And you can be sure that at one moment there was one vote, and it's kind of timestamping in the blockchain, and you can't say no in the future.
How your project will be better than other vote application?
In a way, and it's to add to the previous question, we use the blockchain because even if Diaphanous, which we hope won't, dies or disappears, we could retrieve the data from the blockchain. So that makes this application, in a way, agnostic to our success or failure. While the other voting systems are not.
You mentioned that it's end-to-end very, very, very viable. Can we delegate a vote to someone? And if so, can we check that the guidelines we gave him to vote was really was the vote that he made?
Well, it's not yet implemented, but the protocol let us do this, so we can see in the future some delegate votes that you are sending your token to someone who is also from the participants. Say, like every participant has been received our token or transaction at the beginning, saying is in the database from the participant. So if it's in there, you can send the token and it can vote for you.
So you used the word trusted at the beginning, so yeah, I think Alex asked the right question. But outside of the, you don't need a blockchain for that, why? So when you say end-to-end, not really, because you have no proof that the person you're issuing the coin to at the beginning is the real person. So how do you deal with somebody coming up after the vote saying, hey, I never got my token, or it's not me voting, it's somebody else?
Well, we can see a program where to be part from the audience, for example, in ministry or something, you need to send documents saying you're from this system, and if your documents are okay, we send you a transaction, it's in the blockchain, we can see that you received the transaction, it's your public address, so then when you have the token, you can vote. And if you never provide the document and after the beginning of the vote, you're not inside the program, you can say, and so you never receive any fund, so you're not in the block, you're not in the, so you never receive the token.
Okay, and so in the implementation, I really like the demo, because it's pretty good. There's a few things that were weird, especially with something you said. So you were saying that the consensus wouldn't be a problem, but it actually is. But in your implementation, you're waiting for a confirmation, which is good. Now, why does, well, like when you did the transaction yourself, so you were sending the colored coin to one of the address, obviously it didn't count because it didn't have the confirmation, but then you said, oh yeah, so there it disappeared because, and why is this because?
Well, because it's still a transaction, so it's not the token, it's just what you're seeing, it's just the token holders. So it, at the beginning it's going away from the token holders, but because it's not yet confirmed, it's not in the other address.
So where is it?
well, it's in the way.
In the cloud.
All right, thank you. So next team is Data. You tell me.
Questions. Everyone, welcome to Theaters. So first I wanted to ask you a question. Who here has Bitcoin or Ether? Raise your hand. Keep your hands up. Who among you bought these Bitcoin or Ethers with cash? 1, 2, 3% Well, that's very little. Because actually, when you look at Satoshi's white paper, that we see, he talks about peer-to-peer electronic cash system. It is an electronic system, but is it peer-to-peer? I don't think so. So how do we buy now on currency? You can see that most of us go on exchanges like Kraken, and we actually made big transfers, which is actually centralized. It takes a long time, and you take risk. What we do now, we're building Ether. Ether is a mobile app that enables anyone to buy and sell cryptocurrency in here, Ethers, securely, locally, and with just thanks to blockchain. So why use a blockchain in this case? Unlike local bitcoins or mycelium, it's secure and trustworthy. Secure because we actually put the crypto money into escrow. Unlike local bitcoins, we don't take the money, then give it to the buyer. It's completely on the blockchain. Second, we build a decentralized rating system based on the number of transactions and the volume of transactions that is actually secured and not centralized like mycelium, for example. So what's our business model? We will be actually referencing businesses on the second time, and they will be able to actually accept or not this means of payment or to make exchange currency fiat to crypto. So here's the demo.
Hello, my name is Jenna and I'm
going to
walk you through the live demo. So here is our app. So it's supposed to be a mobile app. Right now it's built on React. Later on, we plan on building it on React Native, so that's why that's the shape of it. So, so the way it's built, we have one basic smart contract. sorry, it was whatever. So, let's say I'm someone who wants to sell Ether. So I'm going to be here, I want to activate my seller status, so I'm going to enter my price up there, 30, so that's my price for one Ether, and I'm going to locate my point of sale on the map, which is not my house, not where I live, not where I work, just the point where I want to transact. Then I'm going to enter the amount that I'm ready to sell. So this amount is going to be sent to some sort of escrow account on our smart contract so that it secures the transaction. Okay, so what you see here, zoom a little bit? So you see my MetaMask wallet balance. This is my wallet. And after it, you see your Ether deposit balance. That's what you can transact right now. So now, let's say a buyer found me on the map. So he wants to transact with me. He will be put in touch through like a decentralized messenger that we didn't have the time to implement with me. So we can talk and like. Set up an appointment to a point of sale. Can you go back to home? Okay. And by the time he gives me the cash money, I'll go on the sell function, and I'm going to enter the amount of Ether that we're going to transact. So let's say 15. And I'm going to enter also his wallet address, confirm the transaction, and accept it. So what you need to know here is when I confirm and send Ether, 0.5% of it is destroyed, is burnt, basically, to prevent people from scamming the network and do transaction just to get a reputation. So now I have a deposit balance of 85. Let's say I don't want to buy anymore, or I don't want to sell anymore, I want to get back my money and my Ether on my wallet. I can play the withdraw function, and let's say I want to withdraw 20 Ether. Let's get it right, yeah. Okay, so I'm gonna accept this, and you can see my D3 deposit balance just shrink, and my MetaMask wallet will update. Just one thing, we're using MetaMask here. Later on, the plan is to have a Lite wallet integrated in the app, where like the private key will be stored on the device. The thing is, within the context of this hackathon, we didn't have the time, obviously, to work this out. So that's why we used MetaMask.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Why is the Bitcoin logo upside down in your mobile app screenshot? Okay, so first question. I didn't really see where you put the address of the recipient of the money. I don't know, did I miss something? You were typing the price and then poof, it's disappearing?
We copy-pasted. So okay. The buyer and seller will chat in Whisper and they can send themselves the address. The buyer can send the address of where you want to get the Ether.
Okay, and you did that when? At the beginning?
Yeah.
When very beginning?
When you sell.
That's a sell screen. And you enter the amount you want to sell and the address of the buyer.
But that's...
And then it's not a wallet, a classic wallet. It's the same function on our smart contract.
Yep.
We take 0.5% of the transaction to count it, to avoid all the gaming.
Okay, but right. Why was that done after you locked the funds? It should be locked before, like, way before we actually do the transactions, otherwise you don't have the escrow service, right?
Yes.
It is. Okay, so after that, the multiple transaction you did were with the same buyer.
Do you want me to walk you through this?
Yeah, very quickly, because I'm a bit lost there.
Alright. So, when the seller locates himself on the map, he says, I want to sell for 10 Ether. So, when he deposits, we have like a deposit sort of input form. The amount that you deposit is directly sent to our smart contract. So the transaction hasn't happened, they didn't meet yet,
okay.
Or anything. And
okay,
this
cool.
happens when they actually meet in person.
Okay, fine.
Thank you.
Yeah, I've got a question too. Did you produce the code during the hackathon, or did you?
Yes, yes.
Yeah.
The whole code?
Yes.
Okay.
Only the React and Truffle boilerplate. All the rest we did during the code.
Okay. Thank you very much, guys.
Thank you.
Last question.
Okay, so it's really good because it's decentralized and everything. What power do you have over the app? Can you shut it down yourselves?
No.
So once it's published?
It's a smart contract. All the stuff are in the smart contract. The seller add their fund and all it. They can sell, they can use
it. Yeah, so you don't have access to the money, I get that. But on the app itself, can you upgrade it if you need to update it? Or do you just destroy every access you have to it?
If you want to upgrade the smart contract,
yeah.
Right now we don't have to think about that for the moment. But
Can I add something? So it like it could be deployed on something like Swarm or something like that that is decentralized but still being open source, so that like open for improvement from like anyone who wants to develop it. So.
Okay, so the question was really about, can somebody who find you guys shut down your platform?
The mobile app, yes, but the smart contract.
Thank you, and the next are... Too much.
Hi everyone, so I'm Alexandre, I'm introducing GeoMatch that we created this weekend, and it's being used to build unstoppable maps. So what is it? It is, as you can read, a developer standardized set of tools, to help getting reliable geospatial data and ensure interoperability with other dApps. So it's basically not an app that we deploy in the blockchain, but it's rather a tool that will be used by other dApps. So, first the topic, we use Ethereum because we actually want to be used by the other dApps, and we need the flexibility and the diversity of apps that we can do with the smart contracts. So, main features of GeoMatch. It is a software and a smart contract to create a geospatial standard for dApps. So that's the main line. First thing it does is provide standardized geo formats. So these are polygons, lines, points. So basically these are the variables or definition of maps used in a standardized way. For example, in the previous example of Dither, they could have used those kind of data, polygons, lines, and points for their maps. And it's used for smart contracts to interact with. It allows interoperability, as I said, between dApps because we're using the same standardized format. And it is, of course, censorship resistant, and I know I'm going to get the remark that it's not censorship resistant because it's on Ethereum, but it is. So basically what it does is it ensures everyone will get the same exact map, whatever the dApp that's used, whatever the client, during a certain period, and no one can alter that map. So possible use cases, because we are focusing on the tools, but of course we have to think about use cases that could use these tools. We can think about not only the famous cadastre where you have your properties and so on, you can think about geospatial transaction. You can actually transfer land property into a smart contract. You can also crowdsource mapping, for example, it's related also to OpenStreet map. There are places that have not been mapped yet, so maybe you can tip people through the smart contract to help map the places that haven't been mapped, and treasure hunt, and we're gonna go back there after the scheme. So that's how it works, basically. There's a first step, which is before the smart contract, which is the dApps have to put the data inside IPFS before we go into the whole process. Then we have the device, which is the user. He will use the dApp, and the dApp at some point will give him will give the client a smart contract address and a hash. And now what GeoMatch does, it takes the address of the smart contract, and it set through gates, it managed to call the smart contract, and we get retrieve geo hashes, which are basically hashes that have been put in IPFS before. And when it retrieves those geo hashes, we manage to get back GeoJSON that are interpreted by the device and gives you a map with polygons, lines, and so on. So when we're going to go through the demo, it's live, it's on testnet, you can have the address if you want. And the demo will be commented by Alexa. So we have two Alexa.
Hey. So, here it's a background of a map, so it's only for display purpose. It's a client user interface with a JavaScript code which is executed client side. So the purpose of the project is to, if you give me a smart contract address which contains geo hash of the map, we can provide you a map which has integrity. So we will show you the demo if it works. So okay, cool. So you have to get the address of the smart contract of your DApp provider. So you have to trust your DApp provider, but if you use the DApp, you trust the DApp. So you pass the address of the smart contract of the geo hashes, the geo data. You touch go.
It's done.
Okay, sorry. And so you
get the line.
It requests Ethereum smart contract which is deployed on the testnet and maybe the mainnet tonight. And so it retrieves the geo hash of the geodata and make a request on IPFS, get the geodata which is in GeoJSON. I don't know if you know the format, but it exists. And display it on a map. So this map is alive, and these features, line, points, and maybe polygon.
We don't have.
Yeah, we don't have. So is directly now from IPFS. So that's the demo.
Very fast, we're gonna end on the different use cases. Because I heard that we have no more time. Okay, so basically the idea, just to get it clearer, is to make a kind of an ERC-like standard for geodata. So instead of allowing everyone to create crypto token, well, we allow everyone to use geodata for their dApps. I'm gonna go fast. The licensing of it is basically very clear. It's do what the F you want to license, which basically states that you can do what the F you want to. And the maybe next steps behind that is to be able to upload data and to crowdsource map. The team, and thanks.
Thank you.
I still have no clue what you need that for.
What do you mean?
Okay, so what you provide basically is a way to retrieve map data out of IPFS through hashes, so I don't have the data on the smart contract.
Yeah, you have the hashes of the IPFS pass of the data, which is the hash of the data on IPFS.
Amazing. What do I need that for?
Yeah. Okay.
Why would you need that? Well, we were forced to take it away because it would take too much time, but for example, if it works, why not use it for the famous Orion? So in Orion, you basically are doing treasure hunt. So as a player, you need to know where you have to go next. And as Orion, I don't want to store the map. I don't want you to have to trust me. I don't want you to have to trust the company. I want it to be transparent so that everyone can play. And I'm sure that if I give the right answer, I know I will get the same exact map as the other players have if they have given the same answer. So for that, I actually need to go through GeoMatch.
So GeoMatch is a set of tools.
It's
a set of tools for Orion developer, maybe Dither developer and another developer, which is not the job to deal with geospatial purpose on their DApp. And so we try to give best practice, so like the ERC token is standard for point, line and polygons, and that's all. So if you want to do a token for you, you provide a token, yeah, and so you have a contract to provide maps.
And two questions. What is the technical difficulty to set up this kind of smart contract?
We didn't. So difficulty is that the architecture is quite simple. The conception is simple too. So there were not a lot of difficulties to build this app. So it's just practical tools. Yeah. I don't know if I answered to your question.
So, what's the future for the application?
We provide good practice to deal with geospatial data, like to use a point, line, polygon. But if DApp developer when the proof of location may be alive, want to know if a user is a certain area with the function we want to provide. You can do geospatial calculation like, is my user in the polygon of Paris or something else? Maybe you can ask in a dApp for reverse geocoding, like give me the GPS coordinates and I want the address. I give you the address, sorry. And so it will not be embedded in the dApps, but you can trust an Oracle for this. Or we can imagine a lot of things about geospatial stuff. So.
And can you make this kind of the apps in production?
Yeah.
Can I sell it?
If you want to sell the
yeah, can I?
Yeah,
can
it's
I?
What the fuck do license? So you
to who?
To everybody. Ah, you want to sell a dApp? Yeah, but I don't know. I wait. Yeah.
The GeoMatch is at the tool layer. So basically, for example, I was talking about Orion. We can talk also about cadastre things and so on. This is out of the scope. We are just providing a tool for anyone who wants to use on the blockchain geodata.
Yeah,
so
obviously it's centralized.
Sorry?
Obviously it's centralized.
How is that?
The apps look centralized. So, are you making money on that?
No. But the apps, again, it's not in the
no
scope.
Incentive. And so, why?
Oh.
What's the business model behind that?
It's just a tool for developer. I mean, there's no also business model for many other things.
My question is pretty simple. So, if you win the first cash prize and you don't do any money, so why winning? Why do you need to?
Yeah, if you want to build dApps, which you will make money with your dApps, but we provide the tool like the Ethereum Foundation maybe provide.
So there's an application. So you want to build application on top of this platform, right?
Yeah.
Which one?
Except
Orion.
Well, to be very clear, we use the example of Orion because Orion needs this. So
that is just one example, and Orion has been.
The other example were given also before. Like, if you want, I can go back. Transferring land properties, so you can use the famous big land example. But
that's what I want to see. That's what I want to see. Yeah.
Okay. So, well, instead of just having Bitland, which is just anchoring the GPS data, well, you can also implement, for example, geodata in your transaction, so that you don't even need a notary anymore to sell your house because you'll sell the geographic data and the other stuff.
Okay, back to me. I'm really so lost. So if you really need bad data on Ethereum, just use it. I mean, you can use your GeoJSON on Ethereum directly. You put the data there and you execute it on the client side. To me, it seems that you are using IPFS just as like a tool to hide information?
It depends on who you want to trust. Because if you go back to the initial presentation of Alexandre in the first day,
yeah,
for example, you see that if you go on Google Maps, depending on where you are and when you check, the borders of the country are not the same.
Yeah,
so
you could put that on Ethereum.
Okay, the maps are really huge.
That's a good answer.
Yeah,
okay,
really good.
But then IPFS doesn't offer you any guarantee of availability, so your map might disappear tomorrow.
Yes, but if you trust your dApp provider, you can run your IPFS node and download the data, and so you make redundancy.
Okay, so I need to run. Okay.
No, you can.
Yeah.
If you want.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, so next project is Gox. C'est les Gox.
La chanson.
Mais ils sont où?
Thank you.
It's the return.
So we're gonna tell you a story. It's a story of a rich guy that said he was very, very rich. And I think you will see the parallel with the empty guts, such as the security, such as many things. And finally, there were a problem, and people were saying, wow, where are our beacons? And then hopefully, there we come, and we are there to bring trust and to make sure that we're going to find these beacons. So as auditors, we had the idea to begin our study from the first election, and we have to ensure that the figures were good.
So, first of all, we have a ledger which gathers information from empty GOX. So basically, it sums up all the inputs and the outputs in terms of transactions. So here is, we want to check if what we have at this time, here, I mean, in June 2011, when they proved that it really worked, we want to be sure that it's consistent with the amount of Bitcoin which was asked by people when it went to bankruptcy. So basically we use this file to collect over different periods the amount and to check if it's consistent, because when you are auditing you aim at checking if first if your file is correct, because otherwise you cannot rely on it, and second if figures are consistent with what you aim at finding. Well, so then we wanted to plot transactions. I mean, transactions flow, it's the deposit minus the withdrawal to see the difference in terms of bitcoins in their transaction flow. So for instance here, you see that they collect many bitcoins, and when it's here, they give. They give more bitcoins. So the purpose is to check, okay, because the purpose was to check if it was consistent with reality. So now the transactions are identified and are checked. We would like to thank Laurent Sala for his very good platform on which you can have this kind of display.
So what we've done, we have analyzed all the different parts of the graph, and the first part was the period from June to December 2011, and what we realized that there have been many transactions inside empty GOX, and at the end we had almost the same amount, so we passed to another part of the graph. We checked what happens after 2012, and here is the beginning of our studies. And as you can see, there has been more than 25 splits of the first transaction, and without any significant input or output in empty guts. You have only 0.03% of the first amount of the transaction, and we did not finish our analysis, mostly because of the time, I think. this is the kind of analysis that we really wanted to show you today. Coming soon. A full blockchain audited. We really think that an audit stamp on the blockchain will really allow the investors to believe more in the technology. And we really think too that the audit stamp will allow the technology to fulfill all the promises that we really are all believing in.
Thank you. So they are in the blockchain, we think.
So what's the conclusion of this experience, and where is the demo?
So since it's mostly a big data project on the blockchains, the demo was actually the analysis.
Result.
Yeah, the result. You know, the different the presentation has been solved differently. With this, as our understanding is that this is the demonstration of what kind of result we can provide by auditing a blockchain, and what kind of comprehension we can have of what a client which perform a lot of transactions, that we can understand the rationale of the way he handles the funds and give an opinion on if he does it correctly or if he should not be trusted. But as Paul said, there were many more analyses to perform, and we went out of time. But the main point of this project was to think about a new methodology, to develop a new kind of rationale in order to bring trust to the clients.
And is your analysis methodology works on a state channel or payment channel?
Well,
only on the blockchain. Or?
We have tried to develop a methodology which is agnostic on the technology. The code developed is on R, the software R. The point is that you should only take the data from the blockchain and all the payment channel. As long as it's A sends this amount to B, you know, just the address, and somehow you could retreat it another way, then the statistical data performed are coded in R, and that's something important as a methodology, that you want a code to be reused in whatever blockchain or payment channel you are analyzing, and we did care on this point.
And who the guys who did it with R?
Well, several.
Can you explain us a little bit more on how to end up with this kind of result?
I mean that we had to focus on different kind of sources where we could extract data. So first we focus on API, because with a REST API you can get easily informations. So we use R Bitcoin as our library, but we saw that the information we got was restricted. So after we turned to check if the block trade API package for Python could be relevant, and after we identified that actually the way data is structured is not convenient with the way we want to analyze the blockchain, because you have the transactions and you have outputs, and you want to follow to track the output you are interested in, and then to go down the stream and to find the final outputs. So we have to change the structure of the data, and then to perform, as Sebastian said, a statistical and rather analytical tool to find out where are the final addresses where the money is.
Many time has been spent on obtaining the graph we showed on the transactions to understand what went on, and what we concluded is that somehow in an audit of blockchains, we think it would be relevant to have this kind of software, which is very helpful to understand what you want to see.
So where are the cogs going?
Well, it's still in the investigation is still in progress. But the point is that we developed a new methodology to retrieve the data, since these are unusual data, new kind of data, and so basically the result would have come later, unfortunately.
To be a bit more precise about the question of where are the GOX coins, from the proof of solvency in June 2011, which is at the bottom left, we can track the. It looks like the phone has been spread in several 11 addresses, and then consolidated again in November 2011. And then probably Marc Capelles starts to split the chunk of 500,000 BTC. He split the BTC in December 2011, and the number of BTC decreased all during December. And it's the path that you can see everywhere. And it starts to be really, really difficult to trust them from December 2011.
Another question. How your methodology and tools are resistant to anonymization techniques like CoinJoin, mixing service,
Wimble too. That's an issue. First, we understand that it's important to actually know this kind of methods, to be aware that it exists, and our clients will have to give us the details. So even if they are anonymized on the public blockchain, they will have to give us what they did. And at the end, we will have the transaction of the clients, and the data we will have to analyze will look like what we analyzed, but as we noticed here, actually we only looked at the blockchain and some leaked data of MTGOX. We were missing many information from what would have been MTGOX client who would have to give us way more information, which are the precise transactions. We know that. We analyzed the transactions that were sent from MTGOX to their clients, and that were not interesting for us. Somehow, this is more like a console, like an analysis that would be a console for a client to see what he could perform better in the way he handles his transactions than an actual audit.
And a very similar question. So first, I'd like to thank Peter and Andrew to work on the tools to make your life more difficult. But also, what do you think about the ethics of tracing transactions?
So here, it's public, so we can do whatever. I mean, the idea is that what is public can be seen and tracked, and what is hidden is harder to track. What I would like to say is that by auditing we bring trust. We understand that the last step, so that huge industrial blockchain deployment would be made, is that the audit and compliance parts are settled. It's important for many clients for MTGOX, where the issue was clear for years, if MTGOX would have been audited every year or even several times a year and correctly audited and there would be a certification that MTGOX is solvent, it would have bring a lot of trust to MTGOX and to Bitcoin also, actually.
Okay, thank you.
So the last one is... there's no last one. We're done. Okay, thank you. No. Okay. So medical record technology.
Yeah. Okay.
j'ai oublié de donner une blague.
So, hello everyone. Hello everyone, and we would like to start by thanking all the sponsors and the mentors for this wonderful hackathon. Our project has been rebranded to Hashurance, which I will explain what's the way we rebranded it later. The project have gained 8 members, divided by 3 main diet categories, as you can see. And then we worked together in a project related to health insurance, as you may already understand, because we just noticed that besides, for example, living here in France, one of the great countries in the world, we still have really huge issues related to health insurance. Indeed, the government spent more than $240 billion in health care in general, but we still have a lot of problems like health insurance frauds that are estimated to be around $15 billion, administrative inefficiencies. For those who don't live in France, when you go to your doctor and you get your treatment, you pay the whole amount to the doctor, then the doctor gives you some paper, some piece of paper, which is basically in French. Oh, just a piece of paper saying that you had the treatment and the amount that you paid. Then you take this piece of paper, you send it via the post to your insurance, and you say wait for 6 or 4 or 8 weeks to get refunded the rest of the money. And we also face huge privacy issues because of this papers transacting between many intermediaries. So we try to solve mainly these 3 problems. Our general observation is that in this health insurance system, we have mainly 4 participants: the patient, the doctors, the insurance, and the state. So we wanted to build a solution to answer to the main 3 problems. So we built some smart contracts embedded in Ethereum, so that when a patient would like to subscribe to an insurance, he will ask a state by providing him his social security number to anonymize him, so the state will just provide him an ID, a unique ID, that he will then push to the smart contract of the insurance and pay for the amount of the insurance that he wants. Then, if this patient got sick, he just will go to the doctor and get his treatment. So, at the moment of the payment, he will not provide the whole amount, as it's the case today, but he will ask the government or the state smart contract to provide him a second ID, which will be different from the previous one, and then send it to the doctor. The doctor will then contact the insurance company with this ID to say, okay, I need some refunds from this ID. Can you confirm that this person have been some insurance contract with you? So the insurance, as he received 2 different IDs, they need some trust party, which will be stated here by the state smart contract, that will say, okay, I have the way to check the these 2 IDs.
You've got 1 more minute for the demo, please.
And he would just send a yes, then the doctor gets refunded, and the patient pay only a small amount of money. So this is our demo. We built everything from scratch in this weekend, so we'll just give the steps that can be seen here. So the first time is the client subscribing to a contract, getting a unique ID in order to subscribe to an insurance contract. Then you choose one of the insurance contracts, as you can see here, pay the amount of the insurance to that address so that you get the prescription. When he goes to the doctor, there will be some automatic IoT devices asking the government or the state smart contracts to provide him with this ID. Then he just initiates a transaction with the doctor. So the doctor then smart contracts with the doctor will just communicate with the one with the insurance. The only insurance.
Thank you, Silver. Thank you, Silver.
Then, to get the verification and to get reference, or otherwise, if the ID is wrong, then you get it. Thank you
very much. Too much time on the pitch and not enough on the demo, unfortunately.
We actually wanted to mainly explain you how
the methodology, let's demo is way better first and then explain the methodology. What technology are you using for this kind of project?
For this project today, we used Ethereum blockchain. So as we were intended to build some logic on the smart contracts that we cannot build as easily, at least in Bitcoin, we used
Ethereum. What does it solve?
What does it solve?
Yeah,
it does solve, for example, the privacy issue. Because
on the Ethereum blockchain,
why not?
Have you heard about metadata? Have you heard that you produce metadata on your browser?
Is it? No, sorry.
It does.
Okay. So we
can. So it's not anonymous. So what are you solving?
The three issues we stated before: privacy, fraud, to insurance. Companies, and the last one was, can you get the first slides? Yeah, this one. And administrative inefficiencies, of course, because everything will go in 15, 20 seconds, besides waiting for 6 weeks to be driven.
Sorry, I don't mind. You saw anything, sorry.
I don't have a question.
So what's public on the blockchain and what's not? So what's encrypted, what's not? What's visible and transparent on the blockchain and what is not on the slides?
Okay, can you get to this one? Yes. What's visible in the blockchain? You can only see addresses of patients, but in the insurance contract, for example, you will have no access to any public key or any address of the patient. So we can this way preserve the privacy of the patient. Like, for example, in the case of insurance, trying to see what patient is consuming more insurance than the others and try to increase the price of the insurance just for this specific user.
Yeah, no, I like it. I'm not like Alex. I really think it's useful. It's pretty good, I think. So then your single point of failure is the state, which already is a single point of failure today. So how do you remove the state?
Actually, it's the way it works today. We all trust the state to provide the service. So we implemented this way, which try to find the solution to eliminate the state from this configuration. But all the solution we tried somehow leaked the information about the patient. So we said, okay, our main important point is to get the privacy of the patients at the high level. Say it like this, and even if we can now trust this state smart contracts, but at least it gives us some time to find a new solution and maybe a new cryptographic solution to provide this anonymity.
Let me finish. I'd like to see a demo once more, please. Can you show us a demo, please?
So we have here a patient with his social security number, okay? He wants, for example, to subscribe to a new insurance. So he will just ask the state smart contract to provide him with a unique user ID that he can use to subscribe to this insurance. So this is the first step. Okay, he gets this unique identifier here. And he has the choice between two smart contracts, for example, two insurances giving him different refund statutes with different prices. Okay, so he chose the first one, and then he makes the transaction with this identifier. Okay, so now this identifier is in the insurance smart contract. Yeah, the insurance can still now what unique ID have been made with what address, but we gonna see that it's not a problem. Then our patient is going to the doctor with this address, and this is a new unique ID that he generated. Let's say that by putting his health card on some IoT devices to ask the state smart contract to get this ID. And then the whole process starts. The whole process starts by sending the second user ID, and then the state will iterate on his, will use some cryptographic solution, mainly RSA, public and private key encryption, and then he will find a user ID that matches. This information will not be revealed to the insurance. The only thing that the insurance smart contract will receive is just an answer saying true or false, meaning that this unique user ID have an insurance with you or not. Okay, and then the insurance will send the transaction back to the doctor with the amount of refund multiplied by the percentage specified previously. So.
Okay, thank you. I think my grandmother will like it.
I don't think your grandmother would need to use all this this kind of application, but it's...
What I mean is that it's complicated. It's complicated.
It's complicated the way that it's presented today, but we can actually improve things by building it by using the already existent carte vitale. And some
it looks kind of the same to me. It's over complicated. So,
but better trying to improve than staying with the existing system.
No, I don't mind. I think it's more complicated than the actual system. That everybody use the actual system and nobody use your system. Sorry. All right. So. A little break for the judges, and we come back in less than 10 minutes.
Thank you.